next item on the order paper is a motion on the Social Investment Fund. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly recognises the deep public concern regarding the formation, implementation and operation of the Social Investment Fund and calls on the First Minister and Deputy First Minister to commission an independent review of the operation of the entire Social Investment Fund process, taking particular account of the role of lead partners in this process and the impact that this role has had on good governance.
Cara Margaret, thank you. I call Stuart Dixon to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. Principal Deputy Speaker, quite rightly there have been a lot of points made in the past number of weeks regarding the situation of Charter NI and its Chief Executive, Dee Stitt. But the issues and concerns with the Social Investment Fund go much deeper and wider. The overarching question is whether the stated objectives of the Social Investment Fund, worthy as they may be, could be more efficiently and more effectively achieved through any other means, and therefore whether or not the Social Investment Fund is a worthwhile use of public money. The implementation and operation of the Social Investment Fund has been characterised by secrecy and cronyism. Indeed, in at least one respect, the ongoing association of DUP representatives, including the First Minister, with the current paramilitary as its Chief Executive of Charter NI, has undermined the credibility of the Executive's commitment to tackle paramilitarism. In terms of the principle of good governance, quite simply, it is a disaster. The Assembly should take very serious the comments from the former Commissioner of Standards, Sir Alistair Graham, who said that the Social Investment Fund is flawed and requires root and branch reform. The motion this morning is calling on the First and Deputy First Ministers to review the Social Investment Fund with a view to both learning lessons and to determine whether or not this particular approach should continue into the future. And this review needs to be an independent review. There are very legitimate concerns that the flawed approach of the Social Investment Fund could be replicated in terms of other funding streams, including notably that of the so-called Executive Action Plan on Paramilitarism, with an agenda of trying to buy off paramilitaries rather than to stand up for the principles of the rule of law and promoting a culture of lawfulness. Furthermore, while it is not the role of the Assembly to direct the Northern Ireland Audit Office, it is reasonable to anticipate that the operation of the Social Investment Fund would be subject to a full and rigorous investigation. Listening to the comments from some of the advocates of the Social Investment Fund, you would think that the government interventions to deal with employability, issues of childcare, public health and deprivation were not being dealt with elsewhere. And indeed, it is this point that equally applies to government interventions that were deployed through the community and the voluntary sector. These were regularly viewed as being efficient ways of delivering money quickly, distributing it to the grassroots, and effective in terms of outcomes, and fair in funding decisions were based around objective criteria and open and merit-based competitions. From the perspective, for example, of the Department of Employment and Learning, a number of good examples can be cited. The Local Employment Intermediary Service was a community-based employment intervention to give assistance to marginalised and hard-to-reach unemployed people beyond the general service that was provided by the Employment Service through jobs and benefit offices. Take, for example, Pathways to Success, the executive strategy for addressing people not in education, employment and training. One of the programmes was the Collaboration and Innovation Fund, CIF with a C. This placed £9 million in the hands of 18 different community-based projects to assist marginalised young people. These programmes were successful and popular. They even received endorsement by London-based Centre for Social Inclusion. Money was distributed in a timely and effective manner. But these programmes had to be discontinued in 2015 due to excessive executive budget cuts to Dell. The NEET strategy is now only delivered through the European Social Fund, and similarly at much reduced, LEMS's programme is also being delivered geographically to eligible partners and also continues through ESF. Now here, Principal Deputy Speaker, is the irony. Through all of this, the Social Investment Fund, protected by the executive, despite all of the cuts and the underfunding being expressed throughout the public sector, including cuts that were passed on to the community and voluntary sector, those very organisations that have been delivering and delivering quality programmes. They were cut back, but no cutbacks in SIF. The genesis of the Social Investment Fund, Deputy Speaker, goes back to 2011. The public rationale about innovative approaches to placing decisions and making decision-making power in the hands of local communities, rather than the real rationale, seems to be to control power in the hands of certain local favoured groups of two dominant political parties, namely the DUP and Sinn Féin. To achieve this, political membership was locked into steering groups. This was distributed by the proportional system of De Hunt, which was skewed, of course, towards the larger parties. Some of the so-called independent members also have clear links to the two leading parties. Mr Stitt, for example, is also a member of the South Eastern Group. The most disturbing aspect of the process is that the only groups represented on the steering groups could become the lead partners. This is ultimately a closed shop and clearly a conflict of interest. While we then see a competitive process in terms of the organisations which will deliver the services on the ground, many, if not all, of these groups previously could have, or indeed have, been funded through conventional approaches and funded directly by responsible government departments. Take, for example, East Belfast, a situation where GEMS, the larger and more experienced organisation in terms of delivering community-based employability programmes for government, including some of the schemes I've previously mentioned, being managed by Charter, the smaller organisation, less experienced. So, Deputy Speaker, this begs the question, what precisely is the benefit of this extra layer of bureaucracy in terms of lead partners and associated management fees? Is it about channelling resources into the hands of preferred and favoured organisations of DUP and Sinn Féin? And if so, why? I am sure other speakers in this debate will echo this, but there is a growing sense of frustration across wide swathes of the community and the voluntary sector about resources being steered to certain favoured groups at the expense of others without open and merit-based competition. Without this, we quite simply do not have fair play. We may miss out on even better solutions that other organisations might offer, and we have a growing sense of grievance. What is even more disturbing is that groups feel disempowered from speaking out lest they lose scarce resources that they might receive. This is unhealthy and undemocratic. Groups that I have met with have expressed these concerns to me. Some may argue that it takes local lead partners to source local client groups for schemes and that this is added value. But frankly, even this is disturbing in that it reinforces the belief that they're local gatekeepers in too many communities and that the delivery parties' partners are incapable of doing this directly by themselves. This brings us back to the issue regarding Charter NI. Let us be clear. The DUP have a clear agenda of trying to direct funding to Charter over the last number of years. Sometimes Charter have been successful in winning competitive bids, but at other times they have increased the amount of cunning schemes to try and get them to fund outside the normal process. This would be of significant concern itself, but the interface between Charter and the UDA should be ringing alarm bells. Alliance does recognise, and we do welcome, people with a paramilitary past playing a positive and constructive role in society. But when those people with a paramilitary present are doing so, and indeed are managing public funds, funds which have been awarded through a closed system, then there is clearly a problem. The issue with Mr Stitt is more than the use of abusive language in a Guardian video. It is more than the reference to his ban providing homeland security. It is the reference to working class areas being jungles with the inevitability of local hard men. That is the culture that I came here to break down. That's the culture that this Assembly should be breaking down. That is what goes to the very heart of any credible executive action plan to tackle paramilitarism. For the First Minister to allow herself to be associated alongside a current UDA leader and then to describe the natural concerns expressed right across the community as a distraction sends out a terrible message to wider society. But if it is a distraction, it is only a distraction from the even deeper flaws of the entire social investment fund. Thank you.
I call Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I want to start by saying that I was sent here to represent all of the people of South Belfast, but I draw a particular level of support from the type of communities that Mr Dixon has been talking about in his contribution. I think of communities like Sandy Row, like Tochmona, like the village where his colleague, Ms Bradshaw, have worked for many years in the community and voluntary sector. I think any dispassionate or reasonable observer looking at communities like that would come to the conclusion that for too long they were sidelined, ignored and left behind. And I accept that some of the responsibility for that falls upon the shoulders of unionism. Some of the responsibilities for that falls upon the shoulders of government in general. The fact is that we're talking about communities where the development of capacity, the development of a community infrastructure, was held back for many, many years because of the perverse circumstances of life in Northern Ireland. I was sent here to represent those people, and I'm firmly of the view that for too long they've been left behind. And it's my responsibility, as someone who was born in Annadale, who comes from a working-class Protestant background, to ensure that aspiration is promoted, that education is developed, that opportunities are opened up that otherwise would not have been there. There has been talk, I mentioned South Belfast, and in reference to the party that's brought this motion. I served in Belfast City Council for 11 years alongside Alderman Tom Aiken from the Alliance Party. Tom not only played a role in the development of Weaver's Court and in the creation of jobs for local people, but he was someone that was prepared to put his money where his mouth is in terms of encouraging people down a better path and promoting a better path with a higher level of understanding, a higher level of education, a higher level of aspiration for the young people in those areas. He and I disagreed on many things, although I probably agreed with him more than any other member of the Alliance Party I've ever met. We agreed on a lot of things because we could see that it wasn't right that communities like that should be held back and their development should be retarded. The Social Investment Fund was born out of a desire to reflect the fact that local people and local communities know best what suits their need, what their problems are, what their challenges are, and that they should have a direct and meaningful way to tackle those problems. I'm proud, for example, that I recently opened my constituency office in Sandy Row, and the building that my constituency office is in is part of a social investment fund project. I revealed this in the Executive Office Committee not so long ago. It's not a mystery to anyone. The reason why it took so long to get the office open is because the finance office wouldn't allow me to pay rent to an Ulster Unionist councillor rather than a community group who was the previous person that owned the building. But I'm proud of community groups like Belfast South Community Resources, who are committed to peaceful, democratic means, who are determined to drive positive change. Yes, I will.
Would the member also agree that the community and voluntary sector signed up to the Concordat agreement with government for sustainable, constant funding, not one-off pots that give into their very communities that you're talking about small glimmers of hope, and then it's taken away again when this funding disappears?
And the member has an extra minute.
Thank you. In terms of the funding that you're talking about and the project that I was talking about, we're talking about the provision of a training and employment centre, which will not give a glimmer of hope, but will actually be a lifeline for many people from the community that I have referenced. But I think it's important when people are criticising the processes. In the South Belfast Area Working Group, Geoffrey Dudgeon replaced Bob Stoker, who in turn replaced Michael Majimpsey on that steering group. So I think most of the Ulster Unionists in South Belfast went through it. Paula Bradshaw sat on that working group. In East Belfast, Chris Little, MLA, sat on that SIF working group. In the Londonderry one, Councillor Anne Donnelly of the SDLP and Marion Quinn sat on that working group. In the Southern Area one, the General Secretary of the Ulster Unionist Party, Mr Colin McCusker, sat on that area working group. Councillor Thomas O'Hanlon of the SDLP sat on that area working group. In the southeastern, well, keep watching, you might learn something. In the southeastern,
can I ask members not to be making points from sedentary positions?
In the southeastern one, Councillor Philip Smith, sat on that area working group. In the northern area working group, the chief whip, Robin Swan, MLA, sat on that area working group. And in the western one, Councillor Derek Hussey sat on that area working group. The same people, of course...
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
The same people, of course, who criticised the scrutiny of this process had a direct hand in the same. And therefore, when they come now, feigning concern, they had years to. People will see this for what it is, which is nothing more than rank political opportunism.
The member's time is up. I call Sean Lynch. Éirim Saoire Sean Lynch. Gura mai agatha
priya las cean colla, and I want to declare an interest as a member of the Western Trust, and the last member didn't read my name out, but I was on it. And I welcome the opportunity to speak of my own experience of the steering group and the delivery of the SIF funding. The group consisted of a wide range and selection of people from the community and voluntary, and it wasn't a closed shop, as the mover of the motion said, as well as most political parties was on it as well, as outlined by the last speaker. We consulted widely across the region, seeking interest from as many groups and organisations who may be eligible for the funding as possible. The steering group was guided by OFM officials, which involved a strict criteria. Our focus was on increasing employability opportunities, tackling increased issues of mental and physical health, and tackling deprivation. And during those initial periods, there was no criticism from the opposition parties, only that the money wasn't being distributed quickly enough. But we were inundated with applications. Indeed, we could have spent the most of the SIF money within our own area. However, after much discussion, guidance and consensus, we decided on approximately 10 projects. Unfortunately, all of the projects couldn't be funded. The lead partners helped to ensure continued ownership of the projects by those who had organised them. The lead partners were chosen by a process of consensus. To demonstrate the value of some of the projects that were decided upon, one was recently released when the First Minister and the Junior Minister was in Enniskillen, 920,000 new build for Manor House. And this will provide much needed support to local groups and charities. And 2 years ago, when an SDLP member, Mr Atwood, suggested the SIF was a slush fund for paramilitaries, a member of the trustees of Fermanagh House, which is a cross-section of people, was forced to pen a letter to the local press to defend the integrity and value of the group, and that Fermanagh Trust was not a political hostage to any political party or group. And a couple of weeks ago, at that successful launch, we had the SDLP and Ulster Unionist members were in attendance to share in the success of the project. The motion in front of us today focuses on lead partners and good governance. The central procurement unit was involved in the Fermanagh House from the beginning to the end. Cian Chomhdháil, I want to mention a number of other projects we decided upon and are listed in the research pack. Walk Ready, a revenue project which seeks to provide employment and opportunities for 120 participants. And this is a quote from a young woman at the launch said, "I've been out of work for some time. I found it difficult to get back to employment. The Safe Work Ready West programme enables me to return to full-time employment. It has opened doors to other opportunities to allow me to develop my skills, knowledge and further my educational outcomes. It has given me back my self-worth as a person and allowed me to contribute to society." And a member, a director of Women's Aid at the launch in Enniskillen, which I attended, said they had availed of a young woman from the programme and was now doing good work in their increasing workload to tackle domestic violence. And this is hardly a slush fund for paramilitaries. Just to continue, to conclude, Lascan Collier, there was extensive voluntary input to the consultation and engagement and delivery of the SIF programme. The model represented a unique and innovative joined-up approach to tackling disadvantage and enhanced prosperity. There was robust departmental governance and financial checks in place to effectively manage public funds and deliver agreed outcomes. The opposition parties were criticising that money wasn't being distributed quickly enough. Now they're criticising when it's going out to good causes. This is a case of opposition for opposition's sake. We oppose the motion.
I call Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion, which is calling for independent review of the Social Investment Fund and, in particular, the scrutiny of the role of the lead partners. Looking at the timeline of the Social Investment Fund, it was first announced in March 2011, shortly before an election. I have to be cynical about the timing of that. Surely was that trying to affect a political process? Right from the outset, it wasn't a good start. It indicated the plan was that between 2011-12 and 2014-15, £40 million would be spent on resource and £40 million in capital expenditure to improve deprived communities, addressing poverty, unemployment and physical deterioration. All very laudable objectives. But at that time, the Department of Social Development had, and indeed it continues to provide, the Neighbourhood Renewal Programme, helping disadvantaged areas, largely many of the same areas that we would be talking about. But of course, their remit could have been widened. New criteria could have been set down. You already had a model that could have administered such a funds, but perhaps for political reasons, Sinn Féin DUP didn't want to give that responsibility and funding to an SDLP minister who was in charge at that time. But that's not the reason why public money should be directed one way or the other. It should be used because of probity a good model and good practice. Of course, there was also the model of the peace process, where we had local strategic partnerships between councils and the community and voluntary sector. And expertise had been built up in this area. Processes had been built up which were rigorous. Why was this model not considered? And of course, we also have the reform of local government starting to take place and could easily have been passed to the existing councils and empowering those councillors moving forward. So why were some of those existing processes and expertise not used? That's a big question that does have to be answered instead of the scheme that we're hearing about today. Anyway, some 2 years later, some £389,000 had been spent, largely on administration, but no schemes delivered. That was in 2013, and it was revealed by the detail that this is because there was a dispute between DUP and Sinn Féin. Another year later, in October 2014, the DFM committee were advised that 3.5 years after the initial inception, £34.4 million has finally been allocated. And the expenditure had to be reprofiled from the initial period to up to 2015 to a new period from 2014 to 2018, at least the 3-year delay when disadvantaged communities were not assisted. That needs to be reviewed. What was going wrong? That's worthy of a review on itself. Commenting on the themes of poverty, unemployment and physical deterioration, my party in their response indicated that whilst these themes were commendable. They should mainly be dealt with through the administration of routine government practices. Clearly, if that advice had been followed, we wouldn't be in the mess we're in today. There are clearly really good schemes in the middle of this. In particular, I pick up capital improvements to SureStart programmes. I'm involved in SureStart, and I know that would be money very well spent improving the lots of young children. So there are many laudable schemes within it. The trouble is there are flawed processes, and it could have been any even better. Sir Alistair Graham, the former chair of the Committee on Standards and Public Life, stated about the Social Investment Fund, it doesn't stand up to the principles that are generally held to be appropriate for the awarding of contracts of public on a public contract. So others have spotted there's something wrong here. Where is the value? Yeah.
Both of us representing East End, would you agree with me, Mr. Beggs, that there's a growing frustration, you've made reference to SureStart, there's a growing frustration among long-standing community and voluntary organisations who have taken government funds and funds from local authorities over long periods of time, who have well-tried and tested programmes, and that there's a great deal of frustration when they are faced with so-called pop-up community organisations.
And the member will have an extra minute.
I agree entirely with the member. When there are short-term schemes, there's a danger of not leaving an ongoing legacy behind. There have been some schemes for training and employment in most areas, and certainly I'm aware of the scheme in the East Antrim area, and I'm hearing positive news from individuals who have get involved in it. But looking at the training employment project in East Belfast, where £1.7 million was allocated to the lead party, Charter NI, OFM DFM has said that only £1.5 million is actually handed on to deliver the service. What I haven't heard is what happens to the £200,000 which is creamed off by Charter NI. How do they justify the £200,000 expenditure that they are receiving? It would be much better if that £200,000 was spent directly providing additional training and services for communities in need. And it's that whole process that is flawed, that why we need to have an independent review of this process. And I think at the very least, the Audit Office should be looking and learning lessons that this never happens again.
Éireann Sir Nicola Mallon. I call Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and I rise to support the motion. A network closure, with some favoured organisations being hand-picked by politicians to plan and implement some of the fund's work. This is the description of the Social Investment Fund, not in the words of the SDLP, but as reported in the final research report published just a fortnight ago by the Building Change Trust and Ulster University into the independence of the voluntary community and social enterprise sector in Northern Ireland. The same academic report, based on interviews with government officials, with CEOs and a range of other individuals within the sector, identified as a major concern the, quote, overly close relationship between politicians and some community and voluntary sector organisations. Yes?
Sorry, would the member accept that there are some very good organisations within the SIF Fund? And so far, those that have spoken in defence of the process have completely ignored the point and tried to ride on that reputational, good reputational position that they hold within the community.
And the member will have an extra minute. They know Ms. Breslick
and
Ball.
And the member is absolutely correct, and that's something that I'm going to specifically address in my contribution. As I said, in this academic independent research report, the Social Investment Fund is specifically singled out as a crystallised example of this cosy relationship. And it singly now should come as a surprise to no one. The Social Investment Fund is a masterclass in how not to manage something politically. It was blighted by delay, and now it's marred in controversy. The First Minister and Deputy First Minister and their backbenchers are trying furiously to peddle the myth, and we have heard it again today, that the blame for this controversy lies with those of us in this House and outside it who have the audacity to ask legitimate and valid questions about the openness and transparency, or lack of, in the Social Investment Fund. Their second tactic is to try to distract everyone from the reality of this lack of openness and transparency by accusing all of us who ask those questions that we are deriding and we are demeaning all of the community or voluntary organisations and all of the projects that are involved in SIF. So let me unequivocally deal with both of these failing tactics. I and my party colleagues have been on record time and again recognising and acknowledging that there are good organisations with good individuals doing great work, and we are supportive of these projects. Our issue is not with them, it is with the process. And we are on record as far back as 2011 raising concerns about this process and the continual failure by the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister to address these concerns left our members and all but one of the steering groups forced with no option but to resign. The Social Investment Fund is mired in controversy. The public don't have any confidence or trust in its operation, not because of the opposition, but because of the First and Deputy First Minister, in the way, in their approach and their way that they have handled this. And crystallised, it's been crystallised in their lack of courage in standing up to Dee Stitt, a self-confessed UDA boss and CEO of an organisation handed 1.7 million of public money to administer and given £500,000 for doing so. It is not the opposition or the media which have called into question the SIF fund and all associated with it. It is the silence from our First Minister and the weakness of our Deputy First Minister in the face of Dee Stitt. The First Minister cites employability legislation as reasons why she can't get involved, but she's perfectly entitled as a First Minister to express her opinion on whether she believes he is fit to hold office or not. She refuses to do so. Why? Both the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, almost 2 months on, continue to refuse to answer a question I posed, asking them to list all of the organisations that applied to the Social Investment Fund, the organisations that were successful, and the funding awarded for each project. Why? The First Minister and Deputy First Minister have been asked to publish the minutes of the steering group meetings. They still haven't done so. Why? They have been asked to publish the register of interest completed by all steering group members. They still haven't done so. Why? They have been asked to outline clearly the value added by Charter NI to the employability project being delivered by GEMS, given the huge administration fee that they're receiving for it. They refuse to do so. Why? This House is aware of the controversy and difficulty that I have had in having my urgent orals on this matter heard. And in advance of today, our amendment calling for a review of the Social Investment Fund process by the Audit Office, along with other amendments, were refused. Why? What is there to fear from an Audit Office review? If all is as the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister say it is, they shall be vindicated and its critics will be silenced. But they continue to run away. Let me reassure them, for as long as they continue to run away, those of us who believe in openness and transparency, we will not go away. And of that, Mr. McGuinness and Mrs. Foster can be rest assured.
I call William Irwin.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I say that the Social Investment Fund, I believe, is a very important funding stream for communities right across Northern Ireland. And that includes my own constituency of Newry and Armagh. In Margaret Hill, many members will be aware of the fantastic plans which are currently being processed for a new community hall and changing rooms at Kilcloony on the Mahon Road in the town. And as the town has, in my view, historically not had this type of investment in sports and facilities as other towns have had in the Greater Armagh District, the forward-thinking and perseverance and persistence of members of the Kilcloony Hub Committee has to be commended. The significant efforts of the Hub members has ensured that the town not only has a state-of-the-art 3G playing surface and floodlights, but will soon have a brand new and sizeable community hall and changing rooms to service this fantastic full-size sports pitch, all within walking distance of the town. I refer to this project specifically because I am passionate about the SIF, what SIF will ultimately deliver when the project is complete. Without SIF investment through this programme, Market Hill would not have had the opportunity of this important investment. I do rather feel that the nature of the motion seeks to throw the baby out with the bathwater. It appears that the opposition has latched on to one single matter relating to an individual within an organisation and are now moving on the focus to focus the indignation on the entire Social Investment Fund programme. That is very unfortunate and very unhelpful to the hundreds of people actively involved in managing SIF projects and targeting need in their communities. When I was a liaison with members of the public regarding various matters relating to SIF, I certainly never got the sense from speaking with the groups that the SIF process was in any way an easy process. Rather, there was definitely a real sense that the funding process was rigorous and designed to ensure that projects were meticulously planned and all the necessary procedures and protocols were in place to ensure projects would be both managed to completion and operated to a high standard. That is without doubt what groups were relaying to me on the ground. The fact that the Lands Party has called into question the very formation of this programme is really such a shame, given the countless hours that have been exhausted by hard-working members of the public and steering groups right across the province, targeting need and working tirelessly to ensure projects of real and lasting value are processed. Mr Ford has said that there was never a need for this funding. What a ridiculous statement, and what an affront to the volunteers and groups across the province. Indeed, both the Lands and the Ulster Unionist Party have called it a slush fund. Yet I am very sure that we will have members of each party attend the various opening events when projects are completed. What hypocrisy. And I'll be interested in my own constituency and the members of all the parties that attend at the opening of these events. I say that the House, that this House combined community effort on the Social Investment Fund must be supported. Any issues regarding particular individuals, of course, must be handled in the appropriate fashion, with due regard to the law and process that has already been made crystal clear by our First Minister. The Social Investment Fund remains a valuable programme of support for communities, and with important works ongoing, deadlines being set, contractors being appointed across many projects, there must not be any delay in this programme.
Philip McGuigan. I call Philip McGuigan.
I'm rising to oppose the motion and doing so for a number of reasons. The first of these reasons is that, unlike my colleague to the left, I can't agree with the assumption about deep public concern out there. Just doesn't stack up in my eyes. I know I don't live in East Belfast, but I do speak to people. And over the conversations that I have had with the public, with constituents, with friends, not once has the issue of the Social Investment Fund been raised to me by them. Not once. Now, I do get the opposition have a role to fulfil and need to raise issues to make themselves relevant, and they have valiantly tried to use this issue to do so. But, I have listened to them ask the questions, make their points, table their debates frenetically, like a disorientated boxer swinging wildly for all his might and hoping to get lucky and land that knockout punch. But I also have listened to answers from ministers and others who have responded to all of this with cold, hard facts. Facts that say that SIF was consulted 5 years ago. In fact, as the Deputy First Minister said in an answer to one of those questions in this room and this House, it is one of the most consulted on programmes that I've ever been involved in, and the process has been open and transparent. Facts that state that all the major parties in this chamber took part in the process, not just around the formation, but also taken part in the intervening 5 years in the implementation and operation of SIF. They have, as has already been mentioned, released the congratulatory press statements and stood in the congratulatory photographs. SIF is different from other funds. Its delivery model represents a unique and innovative approach, joined-up approach, to tackle disadvantage and enhance prosperity. That approach of bottom-up engagement with stakeholders from across the community, statutory, business, and political spectrums and the steering group demonstrates confidence in the collaborative approach to identifying and delivering what local communities want and need. I also accept that all organisations that benefit from SIF funding are subject to all the normal checks and balances of public funding constraints. Now, I don't want to ignore that there is a difficulty around an individual in East Belfast, but I have to say that the Social Investment Fund goes far beyond East Belfast, and I don't want to let that individual, like it seems others in this chamber want to distract from what the Social Investment Fund is all about. nor do I want to allow either that individual nor members of this House to put a halt to the good work of the Social Investment Fund that is helping people's lives right across the North. That is the second reason why I will oppose this motion. The Social Investment Fund isn't about an individual or an organisation in East Belfast. It is an investment fund designed and targeted to support some of our most disadvantaged communities by increasing employment opportunities, by tackling issues such as mental and physical health, by increasing and improving community services and facilities, and by addressing dereliction to make areas more appealing for investment. Go ahead.
The member makes reference to the fact that the fund delivers all the things that he's just said in terms of employability and improvements. But does he not accept and understand that that is already being done and has been done successfully by bona fide and tried and tested methodologies? And does he not genuinely understand this morning when he's opposing this motion that this motion and the subject that we're talking around, there is deep public concern about it? But he seems to be clearly wishing to ignore that public concern.
And the member has an extra minute. And can I remind members, if an intervention is given, that they should be brief?
I have addressed the issue of deep public concern, which I think is imaginary. And you know, I should have thanked the research facility for putting together this information pack. And it quite clearly demonstrates that the Social Investment Fund is an additional fund going beyond what has already been provided and married towards that to add added impetus into socially deprived communities. So, as I was saying, while the opposition wanted to talk about something that was decided upon a number of years ago, I want to support the targeted $80 million of funding going to socially deprived communities, $44 million to improving 116 premises, and $35 million going to employment, education, early years intervention and the social economy, mental health provision, fuel poverty and community capacity. I look through the projects across the 9 delivery zones of Social Investment Fund, and I wonder which of these projects does the opposition think should be halted or stopped. Social Investment Fund is a noble attempt to address years of underinvestment, and its delivery is making an impact, and that's why I support and wholeheartedly want it to continue. Gormick.
I call Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to contribute today as a member of the Executive Committee. At the outset, I'd like to focus on the deep public concern referenced in the first line of the motion. Of course, I'd expect nothing less than such negative spin from the Alliance Party, which seeks to add further sensationalism and headline grabbing to this already nullised and anti-Assembly BBC non-issue. Much has been made and will be made of the role of Mr Stitt and Charter NI within the context of the Social Investment Fund, but the reality is that it is such an insignificant part of the matter it couldn't be farther from the melodramatic deep public concern referred to. I'd like to move on from the pessimism which many members seek to bring to the floor here and focus on the optimistic, constructive and successful Social Investment Fund. I'd also like to take this opportunity to remind the Alliance members and the naysayers and doom merchants that their members have been involved in the consultation process and continue to be involved on the steering groups. So, Principal Deputy Speaker, £3.3 million invested into the West Belfast Works project, which has supported people from the Shankill and West Belfast into employment. We've had £1 million into the Bridges Family Practice in East Belfast to regenerate this rundown facility into provision for a modern family medical practice. We have £920,000 to deliver an extension to the Fermanagh House in Enniskillen, which will help provide facilities for community groups to support education and social projects across the county. And in my own constituency of South Antrim, the £3.3 million Building to Employment Through Education project, the £0.8 million Access to Employment project, the £1 million Community Mental Health and Wellbeing project, and the £1.8 million Fuel Poverty project are all delivering for and on behalf of my constituents. These examples of investment show clear and tangible results based on outcomes of how the Social Investment Fund is working as an effective vehicle to deliver social change. To imitate or to intimate that there's anything else or give a broad brush stroke painting it as a cover for paramilitarism is frankly a slap in the face to those communities who have bought into the process. No, thank you. Those 800 people who are now in paid work placements and training, the 1,300 children and families who have gained assistance and support, and the 1,000 children being helped by educational projects are clear evidence that the fund is providing the results it set out to achieve. The community buy-in of the fund is central the ongoing success of the fund. Without this commitment, the fund would have been managed in a top-down manner. Given that it aims to reach out to those in the most disadvantaged areas and those experiencing the greatest of disengagement, I feel that this simply would not have worked. Through tackling educational underachievement, the physical regeneration and refurbishment of community facilities, and dealing with issues such as substance abuse and poor mental health, the fund engages at grassroots and seeks to join up government services with community-based schemes. I understand fully, and do not mean to sound in any way patronising, that our assembly, our business schedules, that we can at times forget that there are swathes of people who are disenfranchised and overlooked. We cannot let these people fall between the cracks and must create effective engagement between the decisions we make in this place and how this filters through onto the ground. Good governance is, of course, vital to the success of the project, and I'm satisfied that the organisations receiving funding are operating with the appropriate structures, processes and policies required by the Social Investment Fund. I'm further satisfied that the Department is carrying out the correct checks and audits to ensure that the funding is being administered in the proper manner. In closing, Principal Deputy Speaker, I recognise that the Social Investment Fund has had delays in getting up and running, but is now successfully and effectively delivering real change to communities. My fear is that any review at this point would severely impact on these projects going forward. The limit on public finances has meant that we have had to look for innovative and inventive ways to get best value for money for the people of Northern Ireland. The Social Investment Fund is providing community involvement and simultaneously tackling some of our greatest social problems. We must look beyond the headlines and see the bigger picture, and rather than pick holes and gripe, we must see the benefits that the Social Investment Fund is delivering currently and will continue to bring in the future. Thank you.
I call Danny Kennedy.
Principal Deputy Speaker, I think it's important that we have the opportunity to debate this important issue before we break for Christmas recess. And I imagine, and I think you've already heard, that there are some in this House who would rather that this issue wasn't on the agenda. But the Social Investment Fund was intended to bring relief and hope to some of our most deprived communities. But I have to say, and that in itself is a very noble thing, supported by the vast majority of members. But I am afraid it has descended into controversy and not a little farce. And whilst there are those who feel the need to try and muddy the waters today and to portray valid scrutiny and criticism, an attack on those the fund was supposed to help, that's not the case, as those who are slinging that mud are well aware. And it's times like this that the executive parties reveal just how thin their skin is. The issue at stake today is not the idea or the concept of addressing areas of deprivation throughout our country, and that is in any way wrong. But rather, it is in the manner in which the SIF was planned and prepared, with maximum control freakery exercised by the DUP and Sinn Féin. Now, I'm happy to acknowledge the very valuable projects that SIF have supported, including in my own constituency, which was referred to earlier. And I have actively supported and encouraged, and I pay a tribute to those involved in working at the Kilcluny Hub at Market Hill. And I have to say I feel more than entitled to attend events at Kilcluny, whether opening events or other events, because I have supported that fully and will continue to do so. Now, so we're not criticising the efforts of those at local community level. What we are saying is that we have legitimate concerns around the control freakery exercised by the funding department, FMDFM, now called the Executive Office. Give way.
Will the member agree, as someone who sat on the Southern Zone, will the member agree that his colleague, Councillor Colin McCusker, sat on that very board, scrutinised everything, and was very, very content with the projects that went forward from the Southern Zone?
And the member has an extra minute.
Well, the member, and clearly the member is in winter wonderland if she thinks that Colin McCusker or any representative from the Ulster Unionist Party would do otherwise. Because at community level, that's what supporting communities is about. So we don't see anything wrong or strange in people behaving in that fashion.
But let me say, Colin McCusker, among others,
can the member just
was
take
a minority
seat?
Voice.
Can the member take? Can I ask members not to be making comments from sedentary positions? I'd also ask members not to challenge the authority of the chair.
Member is young and inexperienced. Let me make it that we should be abundantly clear that there has been that the mess in this has been with the establishment of the process. And the public have been let down, and I think the defensiveness of the DUP and Sinn Féin reveals that they themselves know that. Now, the Social Investment Fund has come under intense scrutiny over the past number of months, particularly focusing on one individual. But it's important to remember that these concerns were being raised over the design and management of this process as far back as 2011. Because in our response to the consultation of the proposed Social Investment Fund in 2011, the Ulster Unionist Party raised concerns. We identified problems with FMDFM being solely responsible for identifying groups and individuals to form the steering groups, something that even at that time perpetuated the feeling of the Social Investment Fund being used as a potential slush fund by the DUP and Sinn Féin. And then it became clear prior to the Assembly election that the then FMDFM couldn't give the money away. In January of this year, when officials from the department appeared before the committee, they revealed that the actual spend at that point was only 4 million. That's 4 million at that point out of an available 80 million. So, January 2016 was 10 months on from the original date the Social Investment Fund was supposed to finish. Is that not embarrassing?
So,
give away briefly.
In my own constituency, there was to be a scheme addressing fuel poverty. Is he surprised to learn that it's only recently been allocated, and I am unaware of what money, if any, has been spent on actually upgrading properties?
Well, nothing, frankly, surprises me about the management of this at top political level. This is not criticism of the people on the ground who have spent time, their own time, to effect positive change in communities, and I pay tribute to that. But what we're about here
can
is
the member bring his
getting
remarks to a, close?
A proper inquiry into the mess of the formulation of this process.
Éirim Saoire, Cathal Boylan. I call Cathal Boylan.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. And I'll be speaking against the motion, and could I declare an interest as a member of the Southern Zone Group, Steering Group. And I just want to pick up on some points already said, because no doubt Mr. Kennedy, and I agree with what Carla Lockhart said, Colin Foster was part of this process from the very, very start and had the same input as anybody else. And for those people who weren't on any of the steering groups, every member that was on the steering group had the same input as everybody else. And I think it's disingenuous to those people out there who, a lot of the members here have spoken about the good work that this money will do, and they're still and all praising the work that's going to be done, but still and all attacking the process. Now, I have to say this here, but I want to go back to start. See, through you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I was going to speak positively at the start about this here, because I think there's good work going to be done, and the money will be well spent. And I can only speak for the work that we've done on the Southern Group. Southern Steering Group. Hold on, I want to make this point first, because I want to start off with the motion, and I'll let you in a minute, right? But as the motion talks about public concern, I haven't heard any public concern. You know, and if we're saying here, and far be it for me to pick on Belfast, if we're saying here that we are going to look right across the North East Island and turn around and criticise all the rest of the groups because there's an issue here that people have raised, and I'm not going to speak any more on it. There's been enough talk about what's happened and everything else. And I've heard this morning in some of the radio interviews and some last week, and hopefully I'll have time to pick up on it. But I want to just pick up. See, first of all, the Alliance Party last year was calling for this money to be allocated in a hurry for other projects. If we don't spend it now, because there's a motion there in the name of Chris Little, Judith Cochran, and Stuart Dixon. And
It's interesting there, the intervention between Stuart Dixon and Roy Beggs. One minute he's saying, Stuart Dixon was saying, there's groups out there already doing this work, so, you know, why shouldn't they undertake it? This was to provide added value on a strategic intervention to help groups out there that hasn't been supported. That's what it was all... That's what it was about, because I represent people in my area that hasn't had money and hasn't had interventions. And then Mr. Beggs, what does Mr. Beggs say? Mr. Beggs starts talking about lead partners, and in one sense he says, given work to certain lead partners, that's going to cream off the money. And on the opposite hand, he was talking about why didn't he give it to council and other groups who've done the work. Well, the Southern Steering Group has give the lead to both Armagh, Banbridge and Craigavon Council and Down Council, who have the capacity to deliver these programmes. Hold on a minute.
I thank the member for giving way, and I hear quite firmly from the executive spokespeople here today, it appears, that there's such confidence in the process. Could you then explain the tremor that exists when an independent review is mentioned?
And the member has an extra minute.
There's no tremor at all. It's not here. The thing about it is this here. Your colleague sat on a group with me and agreed the projects. And no doubt will turn up at the photographs when they're presented.
Can
there's
I
no
ask
tremor.
Members to address their comments through the chair?
Sorry, through you. And the thing
members
about
not
is,
to be making comments.
If the member's saying to me then that an independent process, and her colleague talked about an audit in her contribution, if you genuinely think that I am going to support a process after spending 4 years with all of those people bringing these projects forward to delay this after this time, there's not a chance. So in answer to your question, no. It's not a fear of an independence. It's, we have now discussed this with these groups, and these groups are looking forward to this money being spent. Mr. Beggs.
On some projects, local councils have acted as lead bodies. My question has been, why has that process not been followed everywhere? How can you justify £200,000 being paid to one lead body, and then the project that are actually delivering the funding, helping people on the ground, have additional, I understand, about £300,000 of public funding on administration? So almost a third of the project went on administration. Fewer people were helped on the ground than should have been.
Thank you. Through you, honestly. Why didn't you ask your colleagues or some of your representatives on those groups? That's the question. I want to finish on the point here, because it was interesting what the debate was over the last couple of days. Mr. Ford was on last Friday, I think, and he talked about Mr. Little going on some of the groups. He was asked why he put him on the group. And I think himself was Mr. Little on that group with eyes wide shut, or was it for Luxie or whatever? Because he had the opportunity as a steering group member to ask questions, because the question, and Paula Bradshaw was on this morning as well, every one of us who went on the group signed a memorandum. So we did. So here's the rules of it. So disclose any potential conflict of interest on joining the steering group, and if they arise during the course of the membership, to disclose that at any point in time. Another key important point for all those members on the group is this, is the steering group, fraud and irregularity, the steering group shall be aware that the department is required to adopt and implement policies and practices to safeguard itself against fraud and irregularity. All cases of attempted, suspected, or proven fraud shall be reported to the steering group of the department or relevant authorities as soon as they are discovered. So there was ample opportunity for people if they thought there was issues. I didn't see any issues, so I'll not be
The member's time is up. I call Edwin Poots.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. First of all, I don't stand here today to defend the Strategic Investment Fund. I stand here today to commend it. And I hope that the Executive Office has the will to do a SIF too, because I think SIF has been doing wonderful work out there, and it has been targeted by a small number of people who have went after one individual who made a stupid and flippant remark, which means that everybody who has benefited from SIF are now the targets of individuals in this chamber who are acting for out of political interests and not in the public interest in this instance. I note the Alliance Party and all that they've been saying, and I note that in North Down Council, for example, Alderman Wilson, who is an Alliance person, chaired our meeting on the 7th of May 2013, and at that meeting, who was in attendance but none other than David Stitt and Robert Scott, and those members were congratulated on the informative presentation on the progress on the project on Cooley Sports Forum business plan. That's a meeting chaired by the Alliance Party. Also in attendance was one Councillor Muir, and he seemed to pay a lot of attention to these things because he was in attendance again at another meeting on the 7th of October 2014. And again, Councillor Wilson was there when it was discussed. And again, in a further meeting on the 14th of October 2015, when it was chaired by none other than Councillor Armstrong. I think it's the same Kelly Armstrong who is now in this Assembly. So here we have the Alliance Party, who were taking a full part in the process and giving the money to an organisation headed up by Mr Stitt, and they didn't have an issue. They were in the meetings commending them, commending Mr Stitt for his wonderful work. And here they are today complaining because of one stupid, flippant remark. Let me be very clear. The work that is being done by the communities is an excellent work. And Ms Long, at the invitation of her Alliance councillors, was to come to Lisburn last week and see the work that was going on in the Resurgam initiative. But on the last day, on the very day she was to come, she cancelled it. Claimed she had a conflict of interest because she was going to be in this debate here today, wherever she is. How is it a conflict of interest to actually come and see what is happening on the ground? And if she had bothered to come and see what is happening on the ground, she would have seen initiatives that involved youth work. She would have seen buildings that were being put up in deprived communities, which is making a real tangible difference. And Mr Lunn, he knows what's going on in the Lisburn community. He knows the benefit. Whenever there's something taking place in Resurgam, the Alliance councillors are tripping over themselves to get into photographs and everything else to be associated with it. But Ms Long decided to pull out of it. Let me tell you of one of the key initiatives that's happening. The Early Years Initiative in Lisburn. I commend it to every constituency in Northern Ireland. Because we identified a serious problem with that educational tail and young people not achieving at the higher end, those young people are now being targeted at nursery and at early primary years. Money from SIF is going into speech therapy. It's being channeled through Resurgam. They could have kept the money themselves and spent it, but they put it through the schools. It's being channeled through the schools. And those children are coming to school as a consequence, ready and able to take on the lessons. And they will not form that educational tail that has happened in working class, deprived, loyalist areas, and has happened very, very often. And I commend those kinds of initiatives. We have heard politicians today from all over, Mr Kennedy and others, saying about the great projects that have been happening, but this is a terrible fund that is actually delivering these projects. The truth is, this is a hypocritical motion from a hypocritical party. SIF is doing great work. It is doing wonderful work. I want to see it going forward. And instead of targeting because of one individual making a stupid comment, let's look at the good that's coming out of this. The same people hadn't anything to say whenever, through neighbourhood renewal and all sorts of things, ex-prisoners groups were getting the money, which was going six or seven times more to Republican areas.
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
The money coming to a loyalist areas, and I'm proud to be a loyalist, by the way, loyal to the Queen and loyal to my country, then the Alliance Party are complaining.
I call Claire Hannah, and before I call Claire Hannah, I have to just let the member know you have 2 minutes.
2 minutes, okay. Well, my colleague Nicola Mallon has outlined our consistent concerns about the process, the lack of open tender, the consistently opaque responses of OFM, DFM, and the multi-layered unresolved conflict of interest. And it's worth saying that government speaker after government speaker throwing up straw men of the good projects that we all acknowledge here are immorally using them for cover, and each one of you has failed to acknowledge the concerns, the substantive concerns that have been raised by many people and that are acknowledged, the deep concern in the DUP's own amendment on this. The fact is, these flaws aren't oversights in the process. They are exactly doing what, as Mr McGuinness said last month, this fund was designed to do, and that's hand money to this executive's preferred partners. And it's the character of those preferred partners that is troubling very many people. We're told that groups are in transition, but with absolutely no deadline for when they're supposed to become former paramilitaries. It's of course true that just because you have a past doesn't mean you can't have a future, but you can't expect to be paid to be the future while simultaneously being the past. We all voted in 1998 for paramilitary prisoners to be reintegrated. We didn't vote for the elitism and the patronage that has happened since that has elevated people above their neighbourhoods, and sending those same neighbours to those people for renewal advice and employment advice is cruel. 2 decades after the ceasefires, and with most people much longer out of jail than they were in, the time for rewards for good behaviour is long since over. So as much as anything and about the process, this is about the failing of the executive to tackle paramilitarism and the out-of-date groupthink of co-opting the troublemakers in order to make them a permanent part of our community infrastructure. We're supposed to be giving money to people who are consistently a good example to the communities. Toy soldier D. Stitt is absolutely not that. And if you won't face down that man, how can we have any confidence that you'll face down hundreds of other paramilitaries?
I call Junior Minister Ross to respond to the debate.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I suppose following the considerable media attention given the SIF in recent weeks, it was inevitable that a motion such as this would be tabled. And of course, it's the role of the Assembly to scrutinise the executive programmes. But it is concerning that it seems to be in response to what could be described as sensationalist and at times ill-informed media commentary around the Social Investment Fund project. It is deeply unfortunate that recent media coverage, focusing mainly on one individual, has proven to be a distraction from what is in reality an innovative government project that's changing communities and changing lives right across Northern Ireland. It is a project that is about communities identifying their own needs and how to address them, rather than the top-down government approach that is imposing solutions upon communities. Therefore, before I address the points raised in the motion, I want to highlight some of the valuable opportunities that SIF is providing to people in need and the very positive impact that it's having on people's lives. The Social Investment Fund is now in full delivery mode, with all projects prioritised by local steering groups now approved and funding committed and within zonal budgets. A total of 68 projects will be delivered, 49 capital projects which will make improvements to 115 individual premises, and 19 revenue-focused projects, primarily on support for employment, early intervention in education, as well as mental health, community capacity, transport, social economy and fuel poverty. Whilst the projects committed are at the various stages of the delivery cycle, significant progress has been made over the last 18 months, with many projects now at the delivery stage. As a result, 42 projects worth £54 million have commenced, and 16 projects worth £27 million are now operational. 5 capital projects have now completed their construction works and are providing vital services in local communities. I personally had the enormous privilege of opening the Bridges Family Practice in East Belfast, which has totally transformed a once derelict and unused Bryson Street surgery in the Newton Arch Road into a state-of-the-art health centre accessible to everyone in the local community. The extension to Fermanagh House in Enniskillen has also now been officially opened by the First Minister and by Junior Minister Ferrin. This SIF investment has transformed this property into a larger, more spacious environment with the capacity to offer increased services to local people and provide a one-stop shop. It will make a really positive difference to people in that local community. Very, very briefly.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. I will be very brief. The Minister will be aware that on Charter NI's website it lists its funding organisations. Not only the government, Belfast City Council, the Housing Executive, and a government department that up until 6 months ago was under the control of the Alliance Party. Does the Minister agree with me that if there was some vast conspiracy involving a slush fund, the Alliance Party were obviously part of it as well?
Well, I think that point has been well made and aired over the recent weeks in terms of some of the hypocrisy, who has funded that particular organisation. But again, I don't want to focus on one organisation because I think it does do a disservice to the entire SIF fund. I want to make some progress, Ms. Madam Speaker. There's a lot to get through and I don't have a lot of time. I want to talk about some of the other projects, such as the West Lisburn Community Centre. That's also being completed, which is transforming it into a dedicated youth facility. It's modelled on current youth development centres, such as those in Laurel Hill and the Cullen area, and contains a range of spaces, such as a sports hall, drop-in facilities, group rooms, art space and kitchen facilities.
These new facilities are allowing that centre to become a safe environment where the community can centralise its youth activities and where young people can develop and interact. Youth provision will expand due to the increased capacity of the centre and increased ability to operate projects from a dedicated youth facility. And only a few weeks ago I went down to visit the Lanyon Tunnels project with my colleague, the Junior Minister Fearon, and with the Lord Mayor of Belfast, seeing how, again, innovative solutions to reinvigorate a part of the city that has led derelict for many years, and a way in which you're connecting local communities to the city centre, and again is a great example of thinking outside the box in terms of projects. And these are only some of the valuable projects that the capital investment from CIF has brought to local communities, and there are many, many more. To date, over 6,000 participants are engaged in Social Investment Fund revenue projects. These are local people we are supporting in key areas such as employment, early intervention and education right across all of Northern Ireland. We are investing £18.5 million in employment-focused projects, and we are currently supporting over 1,300 people through training and paid work placements. These are placing local people with local employers, and over 100 people have already secured full-time jobs out of this, and they credit their success directly to their engagement with CIF projects, particularly as most of the jobs are with the CIF project employers. One of those projects, the Work Ready West in the Western Zone, has just completed its interim evaluation and demonstrates real examples of people turning their lives around as a result of the intervention received. 31 individuals have left the project to date, and of these, 20 have moved into employment or self-employment. That's a 65% success rate, which shows just how much of an impact that this project is making. In addition, local people are openly speaking at events to demonstrate how much the project have impacted upon their lives. One of the participants spoke about how her children felt that they had a different mother since she's been on the placement. She herself, having been out of work for several years, acknowledged that she had no confidence or self-belief to even attempt to apply for a job. She spoke about how straightforward the process was to secure a placement and how the ongoing support from both the employer and the project officers has truly changed her life and that of her family. I've had the opportunity to visit a number of these employability projects in South Belfast and West Belfast and Portadown, and was able to speak to people encouraged back into work who have set up their own business and given the confidence to try to make a difference and move on in their lives. £5.7 million is also being invested in early intervention projects across the CIF zones. They're providing a range of family support interventions in schools and communities to support physical, intellectual, social and emotional development. Over 2,000 participants are already availing of the services. Many are sharing positive examples of how the support has helped them. And one of the other key areas in which CIF funds are focusing support is on the area of education. One project is now operational, with another two due to become operational over the coming months. This equates to over £5.5 million worth of investment in educational support to improve the life chances of those who need it most. Over 3,000 people are already engaged in support from the types of projects being rolled out, including improving education and skills to create greater employment opportunities, dedicated maths and English support at Key Stage 2 and 3, and literacy support for primary school children and family support to better integrate schools and communities. I'm not giving away. I want to emphasise these points because the Social Investment Fund really is making a difference to people's lives and benefiting local communities. The negative press coverage and continued focus on a process which was openly consulted on and finalised based on the outcome of that consultation is continuing to distract from the real value that the programme is bringing, which I've said is a shame. Let me address some of the points raised in the motion and during the debate today. Firstly, there is reference to what is quoted as deep public concern regarding the formation, implementation and operation of the Social Investment Fund. The fact that some opposition politicians have welcomed CIF projects in their own areas, sat on steering groups or turned up for smiling for photographs, whilst at the same time choosing to criticise the fund, is a point that will not be missed by the general public. Let me make it absolutely clear to the House this morning that the development and final operation of the fund was the subject of in-depth public consultation. Not only was there a pre-discussion paper published for public comment, but this was followed by a formal public consultation process which included public events, an online questionnaire and the option to provide written responses. Almost 600 people engaged in this process and provided their views on how CIF should operate. This included views on how steering groups should be selected and how the programme should be delivered. And again, I want to emphasise the point that the Department took this process very seriously, and the final programme which emerged was a direct result of what the public told us that they wanted. For example, 48% of respondents preferred option 4 in relation to the establishment of steering groups, that is, that the then Department of First and Deputy First Minister would invite groups and individuals to indicate interest in serving on the steering group. This was subsequently the approach that was adopted. Similarly, when asked about the delivery method, 72% of people opted for option 2, the community option, in that resources would be allocated directly to one or more organisations nominated by the steering group, which would in turn deploy these resources to projects included in the strategic area plan. Again, this was the approach that was adopted. I therefore have to come to the conclusion that it's contradictory to imply a deep public concern about the formation, implementation and operation of a fund when its operation is based on exactly what people told us they wanted as part of that public consultation. The motion also talks about an independent review of the operation of the entire social investment process. Let me inform the House. The Office of Government Commerce developed the Gateway Project Review process and introduced it across government as part of the modernisation agenda to support the delivery of improved public services. And that process has been operating since January 2001. The Gateway Review process is a series of short, focused, independent peer reviews at key stages of a project or a programme. The reviews highlight risks and issues which, if not addressed, would threaten successful delivery. The reviews are carried out by a team of experienced people, independent of the project or programme team, and chosen because of their relevant skills. All reviewers have to go through an accreditation process and training. The Social Investment Fund programme has undergone no fewer than 4 gateway reviews, commencing back in 2011-12 and continuing as the programme has developed, with the recommendations from each review being implemented. And we're in the process of preparing to undergo a 5th gateway review as part of the ongoing quality assurance of, I'm not going away because I have very little time left, of that programme. If people want government to be innovative and innovative policy making, it requires continual review and adaptation and agile response. And this is an example of a type of innovative project that government has tried to do. It's also worth saying that all government programmes are subject to both internal and external audit, and SIF is no different to any other programme. Regarding the role of lead partners, as I've already said, the decision to adopt the lead partner approach was a direct result of the consultation responses, in which the public selected this as a preferred delivery option. The lead partner has an oversight role to lead and manage the procurement of delivery agents and the resulting contract. It also reports to and draws down funding from the department in respect of the project. This is not an approach specific to SIF. It is an approach used in other programmes and funding schemes as well. It is a perfectly legitimate way of providing project oversight and ensuring that the original thinking behind the project is never lost of, the site is never lost of in the process of development and delivery. This oversight role is quite distinct from that of a project delivery which has been implemented through open, public, competitive procurement. The motion also talks about the impact that the lead partner role has had on good governance. Good governance, of course, is a fundamental part of government funding, whether there is a lead partner approach or alternative delivery methods. And as we have confirmed on many previous occasions, and indeed as was acknowledged by an Alliance MLA on the radio this morning, a robust process is in place in relation to all social investment fund projects and indeed any departmental funding to ensure that the capability of lead partners and delivery organisations to manage public money and the project prior to any funding commitments being given. All projects are required to have an approved business case which takes account of advice from accountants and economists. There is also a robust vouching and verification processes in place to ensure projects are delivering and finances are being allocated appropriately. We take good governance incredibly seriously, and we have the necessary checks and balances in place to ensure that money can be properly accounted for. I cannot therefore see how the lead partner role has had any impact upon good governance. Madam Princely, Deputy Speaker, I would like to pay tribute to all of the people and communities involved in the development and delivery of social investment projects. I regret that the ongoing unwarranted criticism is taking away from their dedication, hard work and genuine success in relation to improving people's lives. Some are willing to ignore this good work and risk tarnishing the good name of the individuals and organisations working to improve the quality of life of some of our most deprived communities. Others have welcomed initiatives in their own areas and acknowledge the positive impact the project is having, whilst at the same time going in the airways to criticise the programme. And we've had more of that in the Chamber today. One could be forgiven for thinking that members in the House support the programme, but just not those who thought it up. SIF is an innovative and community-led approach to addressing long-term issues associated with poverty, unemployment and physical deterioration. It is an example of government trying something new and working in a genuine partnership with local communities. It's also a project that is and will continue to transform communities and transform lives of people right across Northern Ireland. This is exactly why councillors, MLAs and MPs from the Alliance, SDLP and Ulster Unionist Party turn up to support SIF projects in their local areas. It's exactly why a UUP member of the Executive Committee last week described the local SIF project in his area as very successful and said he was happy to support it. And it's exactly why this House should reject this motion this morning. Thank you.
I called Stephen Farry to wind on the amendment.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. At the outset, I can say this is a valid and legitimate debate. It is shining a spotlight on what is in effect a DUP and Sinn Féin scandal. Those who have spoken in favour of the motion and who have joined in highlighting the very serious and substantial concerns voiced in relation to SIF, I want to thank them for their very positive and constructive comments. And there is a consensus, certainly in this corner of the House, this is a major and legitimate public concern. But I wanted to highlight the failure of the DUP and Sinn Féin to actually address the heart of the arguments that have been voiced by a number of speakers today, and we've seen actually quite a lot of deflection in this regard. So let me run through some of the issues. First of all, it's claimed that parties are only raising concerns over SIF now in relation to the particular scandal around Charter and DSTIT. In fact, a number of parties have been raising concerns around SIF consistently since 2011, and has been raised certainly by me in a number of budget debates looking at the inefficiency around SIF and whether we could actually spend the money in support of communities in a more efficient and effective way. There's also been a lot of mud thrown around the fact that various elected representatives have been sitting on SIF partnerships and other forums with some of the groups that we have been discussing. What that is about is elected representatives actually doing their job in terms of representing their constituents and engaging in public scrutiny. And yes, Charter NI, if you want to talk about Charter, have been funded through other government departments. But the key point here is they've been funded through open and competitive merit-based processes. So yes, whenever I was Minister for Employment and Learning, I did fund Charter through what was the Collaboration and Innovation Fund. And let me just give a bit more background to that. That, of course, came after a meeting in which I was invited by the then First Minister to run a pilot in relation to FitNI with Charter as a subcontractor, with the potential of £7 million being channelled directly outside normal procurement to that particular organisation. That was some pilot. I did say no to that and advised that Charter could apply, like any other organisation, for public funds. I have to say that my experience of working with Charter was actually disappointing, because out of the 18 organisations on the Collaboration and Innovation Fund, Charter were the ones that gave us the most difficulty in terms of management. So they're not actually a paradigm of good management, if that is actually what they're currently being asked to do in terms of SIF. Everyone else was able to... Yep.
Doesn't the member really come to the heart of the matter, in that from all we heard from the minister, who didn't want to take interventions, he never addressed the key issue. Why was this scheme designed to exclude competition in respect of the lead partners? Isn't the answer clear? Because it was always intended to be a vehicle for cronyism, and it couldn't be that if you dared to have open competition.
Yes, that's very much the case. I mean, at the heart of this is the suspicion, which has not been answered or addressed, so we assume therefore it is by silence confirmed, that the point of SIF is that money was not being channelled to the so-called right community organisations. So a cunning, what are we called, innovative plan in terms of OFM, DFM, or cunning plan in terms of others, was designed to ensure the money went into the so-called right hands at the expense of others in terms of the community. Some people have spoken in relation to issues around public concern and the fact there is no public concern around this. Well, frankly, there is public concern. There's actually huge public concern. And in particular, there's concern right across the community and voluntary sector. Because what we've seen here is the top-down picking winners. There's a lot of talk about this being a bottom-up approach. Yep, go ahead.
When the member talks about the right organisations getting money, I presume he includes GVRT in that. Perhaps he'd like to speak to his colleague in front of him about their capacity and ability to deliver successful projects.
Well, let me be very clear. Paula Bradshaw was not the person who said that it should be the lead organisation in terms of the South Belfast partnership. So again, the winners have been picked from the top. We haven't had a bottom-up process in terms of how the groups have been chosen. But I have to say, there is a real air of tension across the community and voluntary sector, where groups are afraid to speak out around funding decisions, lest the few pennies that they still get are cut by the two parties in the lead. That is not healthy in terms of any open, democratic, pluralistic society. Instead, we're building up a client state. And that should be something that is of great concern to anyone who believes in democracy and the rule of law. It's something we have to get away with. And I think most people in this room know exactly what I'm talking about in that particular regard. Let's talk a moment as well about the issue around charter. I was frankly stunned to hear Evan Poots talk about Dee Stitt's comments as flippant remarks. This is actually an ongoing problem every single day. The issue of Dee Stitt and Charter running this particular programme, East Belfast, isn't simply about one set of remarks that were made in terms of a Guardian video. The issue here is that we have someone who is a current paramilitary on a day-by-day basis who's running an organisation in receipt of £1.7 million of public funds. So we have an ongoing daily situation here that is not being addressed, not being faced up to in any respect. And let's be clear, the DUP have had an open agenda of trying to steer money towards Charter. It's not simply that Charter happened to win contracts on an incidental way. Money has been steered to them, and it's no accident that we've had, for example, Alex Easton doing a reference for Dee Stitt. It's no accident that we have a situation where we have two members of Charter sitting on two different steering groups. This is all done by design. Now, comments also made to the fact that the projects on the ground are of good quality, and I have no reason to doubt that. However, I cannot make a full judgment because I don't know how they would stack up against other projects that would have been procured through other means. So we can say in absolute terms, yes, things are good.
Will the member agree with me that it's only right and proper that we would be concerned about a group like Charter, which is headed up by a UDA leader, receiving this funding, given the number of death threats, attacks on our properties, bullets to our home that we've received from the UDA in recent years?
Absolutely, and I mean, there's ongoing issues with respect to the role that's played by the UDA in our society.
We'll be aware the executive has a strategy for eliminating racism, but it's providing millions of public money to a man who openly brags of his paramilitary connections. Does he find it concerning, given the links between paramilitaries and racist attacks in our society? Does he find this issue concerning?
Yeah, I mean, those links, again, are obviously of concern. And I mean, in terms of strategies, the even wider concern that we have to have is the fact that we have a so-called action plan from the executive on combating paramilitary activity, the credibility which has been ripped out by the fact that we're openly having photographs taken with current paramilitary figures. So there's no point having a big campaign launched yesterday about tackling organised crime and paramilitarism if at the same time people are giving comfort to those who are current paramilitaries. It's a mixed signal for those in the community. Are people really going to be empowered to come forward and talk about their fears around organised crime and paramilitary activity if they see how the leadership in this society is actually reacting to them? Yep.
The member, and I respect the member very much, but we're crossing the line between legislator and prosecutor. And the member has spoken now for 8 to 9 minutes of criticism of who may or may not be a paramilitary leader. Surely the criticism should not be directed at the executive in that case, but at the police who are responsible for gathering evidence, giving it to prosecutors, and then bringing people before the courts to decide whether they're guilty or not.
And I agree with the member, there certainly is a role for the police, and the police do indeed have questions to answer in terms of this particular issue around how robustly they are taking on paramilitaries. But they can't do so in a vacuum without strong leadership from the executive as well around these issues. And I would also remind the member who spoke that his own leader in this assembly, the Deputy First Minister, has expressed concern about Mr. Stitt. So it's not simply coming from these benches and others in that regard. The final point I do want to stress, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, is the issue around value for money. We've talked about the rationale of this being about tackling deprivation, tackling employability issues. All those things were being done and could have been done more through legitimate processes through existing government departments. I dare say the money would have been spent a lot quicker. That's certainly been my experience. But here's the rub. Projects, particularly those using the community voluntary sector across the board, have been cut over the past number of years, while the favour processes and the favour groups through SIF have been protected. And that is part and parcel of the resentment. Whenever we talk about the fact that the community's deprivation is built up, we have a report on educational underachievement from Queen's and Stradmillan that's been buried by the executive.
And
people talk about dealing with the community.
Closed.
The community has been the self-picked community. The process by which people emerged was far from clear. There's a lot of voices out there in communities that are not being given their fair play and their fair share in this respect. Thank you very much.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Can members resume their seats? Order. Order. Can members resume their seats? Can members resume their seats? The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Order. Order, members. Order, members. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Stuart Dixon and Trevor Lunn. Tellers for the noes are Philip McGuigan and George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Order. Can I ask members to resume their seats? Clerk, can you please read the result?
91 members voted, 38 members voted aye, 53 members voted no. The motion falls.
The motion falls. Unfastened.